Analytic continuation is a method that one can use to extend the domain of an analytic function. The definition states that suppose that we have a function f, which is analytic in some domain D1, and that we also have a function g, which is analytic in some other domain D2. If the intersection between these two domains isn't empty, and these two functions agree for all c values inside of this intersection, then we say that the function g is an analytic continuation of a function f to the domain D2, and vice versa. And this is kind of a big deal, because now we can create a new function, let's call it capital F, which is going to be analytic inside of both of these two domains. Because we can just let capital F be equal to the function f in the domain D1, and then we can let this function be equal to the function g inside of a domain D2. And therefore we have managed to create a new function, which can be seen as an extension of a function we started with. And the great thing about this new function is that it's always going to be analytic in both of these two domains, thanks to analytic continuation. Another good thing to know is that these two functions here are called elements of a function capital F. And when you're doing analytic continuation, there are two other good things to know. If you can prove that the function f and g agrees on any small subset S of a domain D, and S contains at least one accumulation point. And this is just a fancy way of saying that S needs to contain at least one point that is not isolated. Because then you know that the function f and g are going to agree on the whole domain D. And the second thing is that if an analytic continuation exists, then it must be unique. If two functions, g1 and g2, each manage to be an analytic continuation of the function f to the domain d2, then you know that these two functions actually is the same function. And both of these two statements actually have the same source. They both come from the identity theorem, which is the next thing we're going to talk about. And now I'm just going to preface this by saying that this theorem is by far the most important and powerful theorem about analytic functions in the whole course. In my opinion, that is. Because this theorem tells us so much about analytic functions' behavior on some domain. So if you by chance are going to try to remember any theorem after this course, it's got to be this one. The theorem states that let D be a non-empty connected open subset of a complex plane, also known as a domain. And let the function f be analytic on this domain. Then the following statements are equivalent. That is that if one of them is true, then all of them must be true. The first statement is that this function is equal to 0 on D, so for all c values inside of this domain. The second statement is that the set that contains all the zeros of this function inside of this domain has an accumulation point in this domain D. And the third statement is that there exists a point C0 inside of this domain D such that all the derivatives of this function f evaluated at this point is equal to 0. One thing I would like to touch on before we continue is that I would like you to think of an accumulation point as a non-isolated point for a set. And what I mean by that is that if you have a point C in the complex plane, then we say that this point is a non-isolated point for the set if we can draw a circle infinite small around the point, but regardless of how small we draw it, we still end up with some point from a set inside of this circle. Which is not the case for an isolated point, because that one will always be alone. This also means that every point on an open set is by definition non-isolated. And since a domain is defined as an open set, this also means that every point in a domain also are non-isolated. And another thing I would like to touch on for the second statement in this theorem is that most of the time you don't have to prove this thing for the whole set that contains all the zeros. It is actually enough to prove this thing for a set that contains just some of the zeros for the whole statement to be true. Because let's say that you find some set S which contains some of the zeros for this function in the domain D. And you also find out that this set has an accumulation point in D. when, since this set S is contained in the set that contains all the zeros, which I'm going to note as S prime in this case, then we actually know that S prime is also going to have an accumulation point in D, since some part of this set already had an accumulation point in D. So this means that if you can find some open subset of a domain D, where the function is equal to zero, then since it is an open subset, you actually know that this set is always going to have an accumulation point in the domain D, since every point in an open set are accumulation points to the set itself. And this therefore means that the set of all zeros must also have an accumulation point in D, since we managed to prove it for some of the zeros inside of this set. And we have therefore been able to prove the second statement in the identity theorem. And since this statement is true, all of them must be true. And therefore we actually know that this function is going to be equal to zero on the whole domain D. And this statement is really strong. This simply means that if you know that the function is equal to zero on any open subset, then it's going to be equal to zero everywhere. But we can take this even further, because let F and G be analytic on the domain D, and let us once again find some subset S with an accumulation point in the domain D. So we can pick an open subset, for example, and if these two functions agree on the subset S, then they're actually going to agree on the whole domain D. And this simply comes from the fact that we can create a new analytic function from these two. Let's call it H, which is going to be equal to F minus G. And this new function, that one will be equal to zero on this subset, since the functions F and G agreed on this subset, right? And since this subset S has an accumulation point in the domain D, we also know that the second statement in the identity theorem is going to be fulfilled. And therefore, we know that the function H is going to be equal to zero on the whole domain D. But since the function H is defined as F minus G, this also means that F is going to be equal to G on the whole domain D. This statement is called the identity theorem for analytic functions, and is sometimes its own theorem in some textbooks. But as you can see here, it simply comes as an conclusion from the identity theorem. And now we can use this new knowledge and go back to the two statements I made up here. The first statement is simply the identity theorem for analytic functions, which we just covered. And this statement is really useful when doing analytic continuation. Because let's say that you have managed to prove that F is equal to G on some small open subset of an intersection. Then this statement actually tells you that this is going to be true for the whole intersection. And therefore you have managed to show that the function G is an analytic continuation of a function F to the domain D2. We can prove a second statement by doing the following. If we have for a fact that we have two functions, G1 and G2, that analytic continue the function F, then we know that all these three functions must be equal on the intersection. But this also means that we can create an open subset inside of this intersection, and in this subset, the two functions, G1 and G2, must agree, since they agreed on the whole intersection, right? But this is also a small open subset of the domain D2, right? So by the identity theorem, this means that these two functions must agree on the whole domain D2. And if they agree on the whole domain, they must be the same function. So far, we have only talked about how to analytic continue a function from one domain to another. But this process can be repeated an infinite amount of times. And by using overlapping domains, we can easily travel from one point in the complex plane to another. And this process to go from one point in one domain to another point in some other domain is called analytic continuation along a path. But here we have to remember that gamma 1 is just one path that takes us from our starting point to our end point. I could, for example, have gone this way instead. And the thing I would like you to know here is that the analytic continuations of a function f along two different paths, gamma 1 and gamma 2 in this example, must not necessarily agree with each other at the common endpoint. This can in fact be highlighted by doing an example. Let's say that I would like to analytic continue the function f here, which is analytic on the domain D1 from the point 1 to minus 1 in the complex plane. And notice here that the function f is actually just a branch of a complex logarithm. And in this case, it's going to not be defined for the angle minus pi. And that is why I would like to continue it to minus 1, since this is a point that the function is not defined for. Then we can, for example, analytic continue this function along this domain here to reach the point minus 1. And in this domain, let's say that we have another part of the complex logarithm as our function. In this case, we're going to have a branch cut at minus pi divided by 2, since if we have this branch cut, then the function g is going to be analytic inside of this domain d2. And the great thing about this thing is that these two functions are going to be equal in the intersection of the domains d1 and d2. And therefore, function g is going to be an analytic continuation for the function f along the path gamma 1 in this case. But we can actually do the same thing if we choose another route. We could, for example, follow the domain d3 here instead. And in this domain, I'm going to choose another branch of a complex logarithm as our analytic function. Since if we have a branch cut at minus 3 pi divided by 2, then this function h here will be analytic inside of this new domain d3. And from this, you can see that these two functions, f and h, are going to be equal on the intersection of d1 and d3. And therefore, the function h is going to be an analytic continuation of the function f along the path gamma 2. So both of these two functions are actually valid analytic continuations from the same start and endpoint, but they took different ways, right? And here we like to note that if you now insert the endpoint into these two functions, then you will see that the function g is going to be equal to I times pi. Meanwhile, the function h, evaluated at the same point, is instead going to be equal to minus I times pi. And this comes from the fact that these two functions are defined for different angles, and therefore the functions don't agree for the same endpoint. That was all for this time. So until next time, thanks for watching.